Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and we are going to finish our discussion on the joints of the lower limb. And we are going to first talk about the different joints that you can find between the tibia and the fibula, and there's actually quite a wide variety there. And then we will finish with the talocrural joints and a few of the associated joints in that region. So basically what I just said there, and our good friend the syndesmosis is going to make a guest appearance here. Okay, so recall like what we had in the radius and the ulna, there are going to be a very similar structure associated with between the tibia and the fibula. However, we don't have that rotation that occurs with pronation and supination here. So we don't have quite as much movement occurring between the tibia and the fibula. So you're going to have joints that are a bit playing a functional role in stability. So you'll have three different joints though. So three different places where the tibia and the fibula will articulate. So you'll have a superior tibiofibular joint, which is actually an example of a synovial plane joint. You will have the interosseous membrane, of course, between the bodies and the shafts of the tibia and the fibula. And then on the distal portion, or its distalmost articulation, will be an example of a syndesmosis. So you'll have the tibiofibular syndesmosis on the distalmost joint. And recall that we have put that interosseous membrane as a type of syndesmosis as well. So two of the three joints are going to be fibrous rather than synovial. Only the superior tibiofibular joint will be synovial. And that makes sense in terms of the function, like I mentioned. We do not have the rotation occurring with pronation and supination, so we don't have that radius moving over the ulna, so the fibula, say, is not rotating over the tibia. So not as much movement, more stability here, so making sense that we have less synovial joints in this region. And if you ever heard the term a high ankle sprain, it's actually talking about some type of disruption to the ligaments associated with the distal tibiofibular joint. So that would be a high ankle sprain. So let's talk a little bit about the ankle joint or the talocrural joint. Now we're looking at a radiograph here. You can actually see there's a bit of a fracture in terms of the lateral malleolus, but we're focusing more on the bones here. And the bones that are articulating to form the talocrural joint are going to be the distal parts of the fibula, the tibia, so you can see the tibia is playing a big role in terms of not only its medial portion here, but this whole bottom portion. And then lastly, so this is tibia, and the most inferior will be the talus, which is going to be that superior most tarsal bone. And these articulate to form a hinge joint. So the primary movement that occurs here is called dorsiflexion or plantar flexion, which is basically flexion and extension with some important considerations in terms of how we describe them. So dorsiflexion is going to have that heel kind of grounding to the ground with the toes pointing up, whereas plantar flexion is going to be the heel kind of up in the air with the toes planted on the ground. All right, so you have, obviously you're going to have other joints that are going to play a role here, but in terms of what's occurring right at this joint, you'd have either dorsiflexion or plantar flexion. And that's an important consideration, as very rarely do these movements occur in a vacuum. You're going to have other joints in this general region that are also causing movements to occur. Now, plantar flexion is going to, the ankle is going to be relatively unstable during plantar flexion. It is much more stable during dorsiflexion. So if you think about standing on your toes, you can only do that for so long and you're already kind of wobbly, just kind of doing it from the get-go. Whereas with dorsiflexion, that's going to be a more powerful movement. It typically, you have more stability because of a better fit in terms of where things are in the ankle joint with dorsiflexion. Okay, now we are looking at the ligaments associated with the talocrural joint. And really you have two sets, one on the medial side and one on the lateral side. And those that are on the medial side are either referred to as the medial ligaments, or when you combine them all, we can refer to these as the deltoid ligaments, kind of shaped like a delta in terms of what it appears as. And these are by far the more robust and the stronger of the two sets. So all of these are going to have an attachment on the medial malleolus of the tibia, and then they will go to their different bones to kind of serve that role of protection. But it's important that at this medial malleolus, they often interweave and kind of create this force in this region, and then they kind of spread out from there. And these are going to play a role in terms of stabilizing the ankle during eversion. And we'll talk a little bit more about what that is in a moment, but it is going to stabilize during eversion, whereas the lateral ligaments are going to stabilize the ankle during inversion. And so on the lateral side, and we have this fibula kind of in the way, so you can't see them quite as well, but these are going to play a role in terms of stabilizing during inversion. They do also have an attachment to the malleolus on that side, or the lateral malleolus, but they don't interweave quite as firmly as what you have with the deltoid ligaments. And so this anterior talofibular ligament, or the ATFL, is going to be the most frequently damaged ligament associated with the ankle joint, and one of the most frequently damaged ligaments in the body. So if you've heard of the term an ankle sprain, that is going to be torn fibers of a ligament, and this is one of the most common areas for a sprain to occur. Now let's talk a little bit about eversion and inversion. So we talked about how the ankle joint only allows plantar flexion and dorsiflexion, but you have these two movements that are very closely associated with the ankle joint, and they're going to be important in terms of that. You'll have the subtalar joint, which is going to be between the talus and the calcaneus right there. And then you will also have the transverse tarsal joints, which is going to be kind of between the calcaneus and the talus and the navicular and the cuboid here. And these will allow for what's referred to as eversion and inversion. You can think of inversion kind of as making the sole of your foot face medially. So this would be medial. And eversion would be making the sole of the foot face laterally. And so try to invert and evert your own foot. Which one do you have a greater range of motion of? It's likely that you probably have a greater range of motion in terms of inversion. And that has a lot to do with the fact that these lateral ligaments are the ones that are stabilizing the ankle during inversion. There's a bit more flexibility here than what you have for the deltoid ligaments, which will stabilize the ankle during eversion. So you cannot evert the foot quite as much as you can as inversion. So that talocrural or ankle joint is going to be one of the most frequently injured of the major joints of the body. Again, ankle sprains are kind of the most common of those injuries. And these are nearly almost always over inversion injuries. What will often happen is that a foot will kind of get planted and it will cause an over inversion to occur, causing for some of those lateral ligaments to tear, either tear slightly, they could completely be ruptured in certain cases, dependent on the severity of the sprain. So think of a person stepping on an uneven surface and that foot is very forcibly inverted. And so you can see with the different degrees of a sprain how serious that can be. Now, is it always an over-inversion injury? Absolutely not. It can be any type of injury in this region. It could affect the deltoid ligaments as well. These are just the most common. Okay, excellent. All right, so just a real quick review here, because sometimes I think this gets lost a little bit. The talocrural joint, or your ankle joint, is capable of plantar and dorsiflexion. What type of synovial joint is it? Is it a ball and socket joint, a condyloid, a hinge, a plane, or a saddle joint? And so, don't get lost in these two terms right here. We got to also understand what type of joint this is. So plantar and dorsiflexion are really just the ankle-specific terms for flexion and extension. So flexion and extension, and only flexion and extension, would be a hinge joint. So the talocrural joint is a hinge joint. Is it true that eversion and inversion play a role associated with the ankle joint? Very commonly, things like plantar flexion or inversion can occur together, but they do occur at different joints. So that actual movement, they often occur in unison, but only plantar and dorsiflexion are allowed at the true talocrural or ankle joint. Excellent. Thank you so much for this. We are going to move on to the muscles of the lower limb. And then we will move into specifics of the laboratory. Thank you so much for your time and attention here. Always feel free to reach out with any questions, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.